Arctic peoples have used dogs for thousands of years. Polar dogs can withstand the extreme climate, pull heavy loads, and cover long distances on relatively little food. Their superior senses help in the hunt, find the way home in a snowstorm, warn of approaching polar bears, or detect unsafe ice. Polar explorers have used big and strong sled dogs to pull expedition gear far into the inhospitable Arctic and Antarctic deserts. As food stores became depleted and the sleds lighter, the dogs themselves served as food. Today, snow scooters, helicopters, and planes have taken over most Arctic transport. While the traditional Inuit lifestyle persists, many sled dogs, also known as huskies, are now used for racing and leisure. To use sled dogs, you need a big team, a lot of space, and a lot of money to feed all the dogs and care for their health and all the equipment. We talked to Torkel Sørensen, a professional sled dog breeder and trainer of racing dogs from Tromsø in northern Norway.
So you are at my home place now. You're at Tromsø Immerse Center. This is where I'm born and raised, and here we have about 200 Alaskan huskies and one cat and three chickens.
Why do you keep so many dogs?
We have a lot of old and young ones and a lot of different dogs here. First of all, it's because we have a lot of guests who is staying here and coming at Immerse Center. Everything from a 30-minute trip till a 5-day trip expedition. So everything in between there. Second of all, me and my mom is both racing ushers. So we breed and we take the dogs that we think are the best, and we put them in a racing team, and we train them and feed them specifically for doing long distance dog sledding races.
It's a long way to become a sled dog. The pups are born blind and helpless.
And you have to touch the little pads. It's super soft because they haven't really started walking yet.
Which breed do you use?
All the dogs we have here in the dog yard are Alaskan Huskies. The Alaskan Husky is not a pure breed, it's not a specific breed, it's more a type of a dog. So the type of dog Alaskan Husky is a polar fur, like it can survive in polar and sub-zero temperatures well. And they have the instinct to pull and run, and once you have those two things, you are basically an Alaskan Husky. And the Siberian Huskies, they still have the pulling instinct. They still have a good Arctic fur and polar fur to survive. But they will normally be a lot slower than the Alaskan Huskies are at running. So if you were doing long distance dog training, running for long distance dog training races, it will always be the Alaskan Huskies who comes out on the top, because they are able to maintain a higher pace at running while pulling the same amount of weight. On the other hand, if you were to go on an expedition, you would maybe choose a different breed, like the Malamutes and Greenland Huskies, because you will have these very cold temperatures. They don't move so fast, so the faster the dogs move, the more energy they will use. And also, the faster you move, the higher the risk of injuries are as well. So when you're out on a long distance expedition, where it's very cold, you have extremely heavy sledge, you will want a breed that has a thick fur that pulls heavy but not runs too fast.
Racing sled dogs weigh only 18 to 27 kilos, but consume roughly 12,000 calories per day, the equivalent of 24 McDonald's Big Macs. In contrast, it is a struggle for a human athlete to consume 5,000 calories per day, despite weighing roughly 3 times more. While human athletes or racing horses tire out after a few hours of hard work, huskies just keep going. They can use the fat and protein they consume directly without having to dig into their own fat and muscle reserves. As long as they eat enough, they can run. Understanding how this works may have implications for human diabetics and those battling obesity. The world's longest dog race is the Iditarod in Alaska. The Masha and 14 dogs cover a distance of over 1,500 kilometers in a bit over 8 days. That's over 185 kilometers a day. The longest dog race in Europe is the Finnmarksløpet, which runs over 1,100 kilometers through the north of Norway. What type of dog can take such a challenge?
For me, the three most important things are appetite, mentality, and injury history, to say like that. So if you have a dog that that eats well and has no injuries, but the mentality is not in place, then after 500 kilometers, maybe their mentality stops and says that, oh, I really, now I just want to lay down and really relax a lot more. That doesn't work out. If you have a dog that has the injury history and the mentality on his place but doesn't eat, they will drop down too fast in weight and you can't run them anymore either. So for me, those three things are the most important. Then the fourth one I like to have as well, I like harmony. I like my group of dogs to be friends with each other, if you can say it like that. They don't need to be best friends, but they're not allowed to be fighting. I need to be able to have them all loose. I need to know when I'm calling them that they come running towards me.
Depending on the type of sled, one can use from 2 up to over 20 dogs in a team. Let's find out how to put a team together.
You have some key positions in the team. The first one that everybody thinks of is the leaders. They are the two in the front. It doesn't really matter if they're male or female, what matters is their minds. So they need to be smart enough to understand the commands, like G for right, H for left, and then STO for stop. In general, you need the brake as well, but at least they understand that they have to calm down. So they need to be smart enough to understand that, but not too smart, otherwise they know that they don't have to obey you. So it's very important that you have a really good connection with your leaders, because they're like, oh, my human is asking me something, I want to do it for him or her, and then they do it. So it's quite important. And then another key position are the swing dogs. They are right behind. And the swing dogs are basically leaders' backup. So they need to be super hyper because everybody copies the dog in front of them. So if you have leaders that you know are focused on opening trails, and then you have swing dogs in the back that are not really interested, then nobody is going to be really interested. So it's good to have, you know, maybe a bit younger and hyper dogs there because they just get the team going. And then also they are backup leaders because dogs are a bit like us. They have days with and days without. And when you have a day when your leaders don't want to listen, then you can quickly swap your swing dog with your leader and boom, you have a leader working. Then another key position is right in front of the sled, and they are called wheel dogs. And the wheel dogs are really strong, but you can put females there as well. And they tend to work really, really hard. That's why you have to swap them around when you have a long trip. And then all the dogs behind the swing dogs and in front of the wheel dogs are called the team dogs. And these are basically backup rolling type of dogs. So if you run 100 kilometers, sometimes your leaders don't want to lead for 100 kilometers, or you have to swap your wheel dogs as well because you decide to put a young dog there because it's closer to the sled and so you can run faster if there's a problem. So you kind of turn your dogs around, and the team dogs are there for that. So if you run long, the team dogs are the, you know, to refill all the position. And once the dogs are really well trained, they actually can run in all positions. So that's the, you know, ideal team, is that you have all leaders and swing dogs and wheel dogs in the team.
The sled runs on, you guessed it, runners. The driver, called Masha, uses body weight and handlebars to steer the sled and shout commandos to the dogs. Between the runners are the brakes, and each sled has a snow anchor to secure the sled. A helper or handler can sit in the sled and jump up if necessary to help. It may look easy to just stand on the sled and let the dogs run, but it is mentally and physically very demanding to keep control of the sled and all the dogs on challenging terrain. Uphill, the Masha usually has to help. This is hard work, especially in deep snow. The Mushers have to train just as hard as the dogs, and few have what it takes to tackle the hardship and loneliness. In long-distance races, the mushers face many days with little or no help or even sleep. The main thing is never to let go of the sled, even if you fall off. It is unlikely you will catch up with 14 huskies who have just discovered their load got lighter. Not many people will ever have the chance to drive their own dog team, but huskies are not just working dogs. They also make great pets as long as they get enough exercise. Even one husky or a team of two will make hiking, cycling or skiing more exciting.
Material was prepared for the project EDU ARCTIC 2, from polar research to scientific passion, innovative nature education in Poland and Norway, which receives a grant of €240,000 received from Iceland, Liechtenstein and Norway under EEA funds.